and good morning, you beautiful creation of God, you. I hope you are doing great this morning. It's been a special kind of different morning in this place today, and oh man, it's quite a fitting morning actually for where I've been and for where I found myself from time to time. And all I kept thinking this morning is, you know, like whatever it is that I do, I just want more of God. I just want more of the Lord. I just want more of Him in my life. I want to feel His presence more. I want to see His working more. I want to see His hand more in all the areas of my life, in everywhere that is me and my life. I just want to see Him. I want to look and see Him. I want to look and feel Him. I want to walk and, you know, feel His touch. Just more of Him, you know. So I kept feeling and kept thinking this morning. And I know sometimes it seems like, or maybe not just seems like, maybe sometimes we get stuck. We get stuck in a place that, and we aren't going any further. You know, we aren't getting any deeper. And I realized that this forms part of this journey that we are. It forms part of the growth that needs to happen in our lives as we go. And the more that the Holy Spirit reveals to us, the more that we are taught, the more that we learn, the deeper we are able to get into the Lord and who He is and into His presence and into where He is. And I realized in this thinking that it costs something. And I thought back of in the past where I wasn't able to get any further than where I am and where I, well, what I'm doing now and where I'm going now. And when I worship and spend time with Him, it's a different feel to a year ago, 6 months ago even. Definitely years ago, much different. Because it costs something. For growth to happen, change needs to happen. Something needs to be different. Something needs to change. We need to adapt when we want a more deeper, intimate relationship with Him. When we want to get into a deeper, more intimate space with the Lord, something needs to change. We need to adapt. Because the way that we are currently praying, the way that we are currently worshiping, the way that we are currently actioning, seeking, it only takes us that far. It can only take us so far. And then change needs to happen so we can go further. And if we're not getting any further, it's not yet the right change. It's not yet the right adaption. It's not, we're not getting the thing yet. You know, Jeremiah 29 says, "And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart." Psalm 27, "When you said, 'Seek my face,' my heart said to you, 'Your face, Lord, I will seek.'" Matthew 6, "But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness." James 4 reminds us, it says, "Draw near to God and He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands. Purify your hearts." There's always something more that needs to fall off. In order to get to the next stage, something needs to fall off. Something needs to get less. The more God becomes in our lives, the other things have to become less. There's nothing that can be on the same level. There's nothing that can be more than God. Jesus Himself said, "You cannot serve God and mammon at the same time." No, mammon, or unrighteous mammon that it's referred to over there. Mammon is the god of wealth and riches. You can't serve them both. Jesus said, "Because you will love one and hate one, you will serve one more than the other." You can't serve them both. You've got to choose one. And then David comes and he writes in Psalm 16, he says, "You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand there are pleasures forevermore." You know, when I sit in God's presence, when I worship and when I press to get deeper into His presence, I get this feeling from time to time that I'm getting to the same place, that I'm getting into the same space, that I'm not getting any further, I'm not getting deeper. You know, when there's this desire to feel physically how God touches you. And it's got nothing to do with contentment or the circumstances where I'm at. It's just when God, it's like pursuing that somebody who you've just fallen in love with. And that's what happens. I just fall in love with God more, of just who He is and how it just feels to be with Him. I couldn't care what's happening and what's going on around me. It's just being with Him, fullness of joy in the presence of the Lord. If there's fullness of joy in the presence of God, it literally means it doesn't matter what's happening around us, what's going on. It's merely, as I said, it's that heart's desire to just feel His touch more, be with Him, having a stronger relationship with Him, knowing more who He is, knowing more what He wants, what He wants to do with me, what He needs me to do for Him, what He wants me to do for Him. And wanting to get there and do those things. Now my question is a little bit this morning is, what do you do when you get into those spaces and places? Do you just keep doing what you're doing and, I don't know, hope for the best? as I'm sure many of us have done. As I know for a fact, I've done often. I'm like, no, I'm just going to keep at this. Something needs to happen. When I learn something one time, it's not really keep doing what you're doing, but keep doing until something changes. Keep doing until something breaks. The same thing as yesterday. Pray until something happens. You keep diving in until something breaks. Until something happens. You think differently. Your heart feels differently. You feel a different presence. Something. There's always something more that we need to learn. But if we just do the same thing and nothing changes, we just hope for the best, it means there's no growth taking place. There's nothing that we are learning that's taking place. To be more effective or to be better or at it, you know. You know, Matthew 6, Jesus reminds us, He says, But when you pray, go into your room. And when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place. And your Father who sees in the secret will reward you openly. And it's not even about the reward. God will bring these things. He will add all these things to you, as Matthew 6:33 says, later in this chapter. God will add the rewards, but it's about seeking Him. It's not about the reward. If you can get your mind to that space where it's about the Lord and not what we get out of it, things shift in your mind. Things change in your heart. It shifts. And it's not a place that I feel that I can explain maybe yet, maybe ever, I don't know. But it's often that level of understanding, that level of want and desire. I don't know if maybe there are people that can explain it. I know I can't yet. But when Jesus says, go into your room and shut the door, pray to your Father who is in His secret place. Maybe you need to change your prayer location. In Psalm 1, David writes, but His delight is in the law of the Lord. And in His law, He meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Fill your mind with God, with God's word, with God's laws, with everything of the Lord, everything. Just fill your mind and fill your mind and fill your mind and meditate on it. Think on it day and night. Speak it loudly if you need to. Speak it when you pray. Speak it when you worship. Just get it in so it becomes nature to you. So you just like feel. Yeah. So you walk and feel God's word, you know. When you're in a situation, immediately you think, oh, you start knowing that in this situation, this is God's word about this sort of behavior or this sort of situation or this is where I am. This is what God's word said. Get to that space. And it takes effort to get there. But it's as simple as that. Matthew 6, verse 16 to 18, Jesus talks about fasting. He says, moreover, when you fast, he says, don't be like the hypocrite with a sad countenance. Don't look sad and hunger and let people see, oh, the man must be fasting. Oh. No, don't do that. Like how Jesus said, for they disfigure their faces that they may appear to men to be fasting. And that is reward enough, because people have this tendency to think often that, yo, the soap must be so holy when he's fasting like this. He must be such a man of God. Yo, wow, yeah. Wow. But Jesus says, but you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, so that you do not appear to men to be fasting, but to your Father who is in the secret place. And then he says again, and your Father who sees in the secret will reward you openly. You mustn't tell the world. Fasting is a very secret act. It's something intimate between you and the Lord only. Nobody else needs to know. And the funniest of things is, I spoke to a friend one day, and he said, you know, the moment, he also said, we made a bit of a joke on it, but I mean, there was some truth from his side behind it, is even in times where the finances might not seem to be there for you to be able to eat, he says, the fastest way for you to get to eat, declare a day fasting to the Lord. Nothing makes the enemy bring you food faster than opening up your heart and mind for the Lord and pressing in and making an announcement like that. But if you do find yourself in a fasting space and somebody invites you to lunch, you don't have to eat. I'll have some tea, please. Saw a sermon of a guy, part of it actually, I need to go finish it, where somebody mentioned that example, especially on the longer period fasting times. Anyway, but Jesus says fast, so we need to pray and we need to fast as well. Those are the most powerful forms of things that we get to do that will bring breakthrough when we feel we get stuck, when we feel your prayers aren't going anywhere, it's not bringing the answers or anything that we need. I speak on the Bible speaks on fasting, prayer and fasting. The body can go 40 days without food. Jesus proved it. But when Jesus fasted, what did he do? Every time you'll see, he retreated. He went somewhere secret where it is just him and the Lord. It's just between you and God. Now, our lives might not always allow us to lock ourselves away from the world when we are fasting. But keep up a good, proper, formal appearance when you are in public. As Jesus says in Matthew 6, don't show people that you are fasting. But it's as simple as these things. Fill your mind with God's word and think on it all the time. Change the location of your prayer. It's a choice to give God 100% of your attention. And the more attention God gets, the further he's definitely taking me. And the more attention God gets, the further he will take you. Because at some point you need to realize, listen, I need to switch off that game that I'm playing while I'm listening to worship and pretending to worship, or maybe you really are worshiping but with your attention on a game. How much attention does God have? At some point you need to stop that movie. At some point you need to put down your phone and focus solely on him. I mean, sitting on your phone while you're saying you're worshiping, yeah, my bro, I don't know or care who you are. Sitting writing things down when you are worshiping, nah, my bro, that's not it. That is partial attention. There will be time to write things down, and if you are a person that writes things down, I'm not saying it's wrong that you do that, but you can't sit in worship and write the whole time when you're worshiping. That doesn't make any sense. That's not full focused commitment. It shows to you that something is more important to you than God is. And while you are busy writing, while God is speaking, you might miss something. Because I don't know who is able to write 100% and listen 100%. People are like, yo, we're multitasking. Yes, I've spoken on multitasking before. You can't listen and speak at the same time. The same way you can't listen and write. Write is a form of speaking. You can't listen and write at the same time. Not effectively, not 100%. You know, when it just shows in a certain time that, especially if we're sitting on our phone in worship, because the phone, that's the one that I can't even pick mine up because I'm looking at it. It shows you that something is more important than God in that moment. And why then would God reward me if I'm sitting scrolling my Facebook feed when I'm supposed to be sitting in worship with Him? Why would He reward me? That's not really seeking Him, is it? Even if it starts there sometimes, though, at some point it's going to break. It needs to break. Set time apart for God, my friend. In the beginning, it might feel boring or weird or strange, awkward, maybe even uncomfortable. If it's uncomfortable, good. Good, because growth happens in uncomfortable spaces. But just get into it. Start trying. Even if you don't know how. Even if nobody's shown or taught or anything you how. Just you put on music and you sing with it. Gospel music. Christian music. Music that is unto God. Look for music that's unto God. Singing about God. Not God, me, God, my life. God, what you do for... No. Who God is. There's many. There are many. There's so much stuff online. True worship. It is about God and not about us. You make that key in your searches if you're in need or you don't know what music to search for when it comes to looking for worship music. Look for music that praises God for who He is, what He is, and how wonderful He is. That's where it starts. You know, you reach for Him. You keep reaching for Him. I mean, God will show you. He will guide you. He will take you places. He will bring you into places. He will draw you near when you draw near to Him. When you pursue Him, He will bring you near. You need to get to that place where it's an unwavering, diligent, sometimes undignified, a continuous, a persistent, constant and consistent pursuit of God, of who He is, to get into His presence, to find out who He is, where He is, if you want to add that question, but just to get in there into God's presence and all that He is. That's just all that's on my mind this morning. Well, there's some extra stuff that God added, I feel. But that's where it is. If you are in any weird, strange place, a place that isn't lekker, a place that you don't like or enjoy, the only answer that I have, and I know it works, for a fact I know that it works, is diving into God's presence, going to see God in His presence, going into your room, closing your door and praying to your Father in heaven, going into your worship room, putting on music and worshiping God. I have a particular friend, or more than one friend actually, but a particular friend who loves worshiping in silence because they can, and that's who they are. They like that. Me, I do them all. I'm more of a music person. If you're more of a music person, then put on your gospel music. Put on some worship music. Find it. YouTube is plucked with the stuff. But seek God. Seek His face. He has all the answers. He has all the ways. And He will take care of you always. That's where you get to Him. That's where you feel Him. I hope through all of this, what's just been on my heart, actually maybe hopefully encourages you a little bit to seek God a little bit harder. Get in there. Get into that secret place with the Lord. That's where the biggest, coolest, most amazing things happen. Is in the secret place with God. I hope you have a great day. Shalom, shalom.